Okay, so today I'm kind of remaking a video I did maybe a year ago, back when I was super new to my channel and I'm better at filming now. So I really want to put this out here, and that is to help people with the question of where to start with N.K. Jemisin, because I have read everything but Emergency Skin and her Green Lantern comics. And the Green Lantern comics, I'm waiting because there's a bind up coming in the fall, and I'm like super excited. And Emergency Skin, I have it on my Kindle. I want to read it. But then once I've read it, I don't have any more new N.K. Jemisin. And I'm not ready for that. I'm just not. But I've read everything else, including her other like short story works, her entire short story collection. And I feel like I am better equipped now, hopefully, to help answer the question, where do you start? Because for this author, it's trickier than with other ones that I've read their works for. Like, I have a Cosmere reading order that I probably should also update because that's an old video of mine. But that one, I usually just say publication order. And you can do publication order for N.K. Jemisin, but I don't think it's as crucial. And I'll go into it, but like talking with the World Hoppers in our video last week, it seems like there are many great jumping in points depending on who you are as a reader, depending on what story you want to be told. So we're going to try. I'm going to try and convince you, A, to read N.K. Jemisin, and B, where would be the best spot for you to jump into the story. And most of this is inspired by the fact that I am rereading The Fifth Season, which was my first N.K. Jemisin, and I love it so much, and I just need to make Jemisin content. I just want to talk about her more. And apparently, an hour and a half with World Hoppers last week was just not enough. So, where to start? This one, like I said, it's always complicated because she's a very consistent quality writer with, I would say, maybe one trilogy really rising above the pack. But for the most part, it's not like she has a huge growth, like a lot of times you'll see across an author's work. Like, there's one work where I can tell it's her first book. But other than that, like, she's an awesome writer. Her prose are amazing. Her world building is my cup of tea. So really what it comes down to is where do you want to be introduced to her? What story setting? What type of thing? And last time I did this video, I had not read How Long Till Black Future Month. So let's start there, because I know some people will start with the short story collection because it's like, well, I'll get a taste of what they can do and then maybe go from there, which I think from one angle is not a bad approach, especially if you really want to know her authorial voice. That is one thing that's very consistent across her voice is Jemisin's authorial voice, which I love. Not only does she always play around with narrative structure and she has really cool perspectives in a story, but her voice, her humor, her satire is so strong. It's one of my favorite things, and you're definitely going to see the different ways she uses that voice in the short story collection. But something she's, in my opinion, not as good as other short stories that I've read is her plotting is not always as satisfying as I have found other short stories to be. Similarly with some character work, but if you just want to see what ideas she likes to play with, you want to get an idea for her voice, you can definitely get that from the short story collection, and the introduction is so good. Granted, I'm biased. I read anything by Jemisin, but she writes the intro to that short story collection and it's good. I just reread it the other day. It's great. And in that collection, you'll see a short story that inspires two of her series, I believe, are in there. One kind of is like adjacent. And then there's another one where she straight up is like, I chose not to use this for novels. And I'm like, but why? It's like her take on The Matrix. So you'll see a lot of really cool story angles in that work. If you don't like short stories and you don't want to start with short stories, which series should you go with? Because she has four, three that are complete and one that just has the first book out. And let's start with that one because that's the newest release. That's The City We Became. This one is interesting because I think it's the most different. This is the only one set in our world. This is set in New York City, and the whole premise of the story is that New York City is coming to life, and how cities come to life is that different people take up avatars of a city, and New York City happens to have six avatars, which is a unique circumstance. And that and other factors make it not go nearly as smooth as it should go. This is actually another one that has a short story in the short story collection, although I will say the short story in the short story collection is almost verbatim the prologue, so you don't have to like read one before the book. That's also a question I get all the time. And this one, I think, is actually, from a narrative structure perspective, the simplest Jemisin. It has a beginning, middle, and end. There's no non-linear stuff going on. You do jump to multiple point of views, but that's pretty standard in fantasy. This one I have given to people who don't read all the time, and they're just fine. You still have her voice. But where this book sometimes doesn't work for people is if you just don't want to talk about New York City for a whole book. If that's not something that interests you, if you don't want to explore the culture of New York City, because that happens a lot, if you don't want it to be the plot of New York City having to fight this other force as it tries to become born, the city we became, if that is not a premise that interests you, if that's not a setting that interests you, this book will probably not work for you. But for me, because I will read anything Jemisin writes, and I love cities and the cultures of cities, I think those things are so cool. It was a great read. I had a great time. It has amazing characters too. Like, this is a really great show of the diversity of characters Jemisin puts into her books. You have people from all different backgrounds in New York City. I don't think there's any background that's really left out. We have someone from Portugal, we have a couple black characters, we have a mixed character, we have a Native American woman who's in her 70s. Like, you have a whole bunch of people represented, and I think she does a really good job of capturing a city she loves so much. So, that's the city we became. And maybe if that sounds good to you, if you want something that's world-building-wise more familiar, and you want a more familiar narrative structure, and you like the idea of reading a story that's really heavily a love letter to New York City, this is a good starting point. It's also a very pretty book. Now, let's go on the opposite side. What if you want to start with the first published series? That would be the Inheritance Trilogy, starting with 100,000 Kingdoms. Now, I'm pretty sure, based off like some interviews that I saw, or not an interview, it was a speech, I think, for the Hugo Awards, that this is actually not her first written book. We'll talk about that in a bit. She talks about a different book being the first book she wrote. Obviously, things get edited and everything like that, but this is the first published. This is the one that first went into the world as an N.K. Jemisin book. This is really fun if you like gods and mortals interacting. If that's your thing, like if you were just like, man, I love Greek mythology and I just love reading when gods and humans get into a mess and things get complicated and it's messy and there's messy family dynamics. She doesn't just pull from Greek mythology. Actually, I think that would be the lesser of the pull. She pulls from a bunch of religions to make the religion system in this book. And you start off with one story with one woman who is entering this kingdom to compete to become its heir. And things get more complicated because of the engagement of gods in the mortal world. And this whole trilogy, though, is unique in that each book is kind of more of a companion novel. They're all connected. They all have same characters laced throughout, but each book doesn't happen one after the other. There really isn't one overarching plot to the whole thing, although there is very much an overarching theme and purpose to the trilogy, is what I'd say. And it's really hard to describe because it is like that, where you have books 1, 2, and 3 that should be read in order, but you're following a world. Like, you start in at one point in the world where there's a transition moment, and then you get to the next book, which has a different transition moment, and then you get to the third book, which has another transition moment, and you're following characters through the moments in this kingdom. It is so beautiful. I don't know how to describe it. Like, the first book, you're in this castle in the sky, and I loved the atmosphere. It was both beautiful and really unsettling and creepy, and I love the way the gods are written, personally. Like, if you want personified deities, you should really pick this one up. Now, that said, this is also one where you're going to start to get that narrative structure complexity that is associated with N.K. Jemisin, which isn't, I don't think, super strong here, but it's definitely one of those things where there's a narrative framing, and you're going to start the book being like, why is the narrator talking like this? And it will all make sense. But if that's something that you don't like in your reading experience, then this might not be the Jemisin to jump into. Maybe try The City We Became, or the next series that I'll talk about, which is the Dreamblood Duology. This is one where I'm pretty sure The Killing Moon is her first written work. This is an Egyptian-inspired fantasy, although it is still another world, and The Killing Moon is more of your standard political mystery fantasy, is basically what I'll say. Although the world building is definitely not info dumped whatsoever, that is kind of a standard across all Jemisins. I didn't really mention that for Inheritance Trilogy, but once you're on a different world that Jemisin makes, she will give you a glossary at the back of the books that I have never used, but is there in case you're like, I just need to know what this word means. What does this word mean? You can do that, but the context clues have always been good for me, and I really like how organic the world building's done. It's very much, you know what the characters know and how they would know it. So if it's something that's commonplace to the character, they're not going to think about it in that much detail. And for you, though, you're like, but what is this thing? I really want to know what this thing is. If it really bothers you, I highly recommend looking at the glossary. But for the most part, if you trust Jemison, everything that's important will be revealed. She doesn't just, like, hold it back as, like, a plot device. It really is just organic. You will learn the things as they are important to the intrigue of the plot. And in the Dreamblood duology, we have dream magic, which I think is really cool. You have, like, the four humors is what inspires it. And the political intrigue is we're in this place, I always mispronounce it, Gujarre, and it's supposed to represent a similar trading hub in Egypt back in the day. And it's so multicultural because that's how it would be. And, like, I really love that. I loved the different people you met. I loved seeing this kind of intersection between politics and religion and how that theme is discussed. And you have this thing where there's this magic system that is used kind of not dissimilar if you've read the Scythe series, where you have people who can be kind of like judgment people who are like, you are a bad person, so you have to pass away now. And they basically kill them in their sleep and take that dream blood, and it has really good healing properties. But it's generally a really peaceful place, partially because of that and partially because of other rules. But we suddenly are dropped into this story, and this power is being abused, and there might be something called a Reaper around. And the story goes from there. I really like The Killing Moon. This is the one where I can kind of tell this is an early Jemison work, because the character interactions that I normally value so much in her stories are just not there yet, if that makes sense. Like, there are characters, and I can tell why they care about each other. I can tell why they do what they're doing. It's not like it's actually bad, but it's not on the Jemison level that I'm used to. And that changes in the sequel for this duology, The Shadowed Sun, one of my favorite books. The Shadowed Sun is, again, kind of like the Inheritance Trilogy, a book that you have to read after The Killing Moon to understand where the world is at. But it's a different set of characters, and it's a different mystery. But I would say the Dreamblood duology, if I were to guess, is something that's better for people who like that political intrigue focus in a fantasy book. Like, yes, there's magic, and yes, there's magical intrigue, and yes, there's world-building intrigue, but the plot is centered around the why is this thing happening, and you get to explore the world and these characters while it does. Now, those are all things that a lot of people don't talk about, and now we should talk about the Broken Earth trilogy, my favorite. The one that I consider perfection. This is the one where, like I say, the rest of them I consider about the same quality level. Like, I don't think there's a huge difference between 100,000 Kingdoms and The Shadowed Sun and The City We Became. Like, they're all extremely high quality fantasy works. But the Broken Earth trilogy is just something special. And it is the one that I first read. And it's honestly, I've heard a lot of people, it's their first read. So even though it's the best, it's not necessarily a bad place to start, because I obviously still love her back catalog. I have collected them all. I plan to reread them all. Yes, none of them have hit me quite like the Broken Earth trilogy, but I still love her voice. And her voice is still so present in the rest of her works. So if you're someone who likes to save the best for last, I guess you should save this one for later on in your reading, but I do think you can also start here. So, what's it about? What are you getting into? This is, as I always say, one of my favorites, because I love fantasies where the main, like, antagonistic force is the world. This is a world that is always going into what is a fifth season. A fifth season is an apocalyptic state, and it does this over and over and over again, to the point where these people are so used to it, so used to the fact that they will almost go through a mass extinction like every hundreds or so years. They have, like, lore that helps them cope with that. And when you start this book, a fifth season is starting. But as the book tells you, that's not the most important thing. Like, there is other stuff that's so much more important to our main character, or at least one of the point of views, who is a grieving mother who then has to figure out her next steps in the process of grieving, and the grieving process is very hard for her. We have other characters who are also what are called origines. I never know if I'm saying that word correctly, but origines are basically earthbenders. They basically can control the vibrations of the earth, and in a place that's always going through a fifth season, this is a feared magical ability, which, you know, obviously people attempt to control, and you can probably guess the thematic content that comes from that. I adore the narrative structure of this work. The narrative structure is normally what makes people not like this work. It's usually either the authorial voice or the narrative structure, like there's a point of view in second person that apparently really rubs people the wrong way. I love reading in second person. I don't know why. I think I like being that close. Like, I think I like putting myself in a character's shoes, so a narrator talking directly to me is not a jarring experience, but I understand reading's subjective. That also does not continue throughout the whole trilogy, so if, you know, you're like, fine, I can handle this for a book, maybe try that, but it's amazing. And another thing I do always say, so like I said with the other series, they are more like companion books in the same world at different points in history. This trilogy is basically one book that's split into three parts, and I think it's to your advantage to try and read them all as close to each other as you can. Like, I think you can take breaks between them, especially because of the harsh content. Like, I say that I love this series. It is not a happy series. You should definitely look up content warnings if you are sensitive to anything, especially if you're a parent. Would highly recommend looking into those things. And it's dark. So if you like finish one book and you're like, I can't jump into the second book right away, you can take a break, but I wouldn't take like a year. Unless your memory's like way better than mine, which it could be. But I really benefited from reading this like one a month when I read it. I think my mom read the whole thing in like 2 weeks. And I think it works really well that way because they kind of all blend together because it really does feel like one whole story split into three parts. So I think I have covered all the Jemisin I have read. And hopefully maybe this helps you figure out where you want to start. Do you want to start with an apocalyptic world? Do you want to see gods and mortals mess things up? Do you want political intrigue with dream magic? Do you want to watch a city be born and kind of like, it feels very like Avengers, but it's not superheroes, but it's like people who suddenly realize I'm important, like kind of like the first episode of Power Rangers. I don't know if this is making sense to anyone, but that's how the city we became feels. You have people who suddenly realize they have powers and are important and need to come together, and the coming together of a team. I mean, we all know these tropes, right? But if any of those sound good, you should definitely go with the one that feels right, because I think if you like her voice, if you like her style, you're gonna like any of these that you pick up. If you don't like her voice, if you don't like her style, that will also become very apparent. So it works both ways, right? It's like really easy that way. And like I said, I don't necessarily recommend the short story collection as a jumping in point, but like, if you know yourself, and I do like the collection, I just read a lot of short stories, and I do think her long form, like her novels, are infinitely better than her short form. I think her short form's wonderful to read if you love her work, which I am in that camp, so I am someone, like I've always said, I will read her grocery list, and I do think that's true at this point. I have read so many things by her. I even read like a foreword to a book I haven't read yet, which could potentially spoil me for that book. That's where I'm at. I just love the way she thinks. I love her humor. I love her ideas. She's one of my favorite authors, and I hope this video was helpful. And if you've made it this far, tell me in the comments which of these books interest you the most, or if you've read some. I don't know. I just love hearing people talk about Jemisin. No spoilers in the comment section, please. But if you want to talk spoilers about Jemisin, come find me at the Discord. We can talk forever. I literally cannot stop talking about A.K. Jemisin. Like, ever. And if you just want to leave me an emoji to let me know you're here, leave a volcano for the Broken Earth trilogy, because that feels apocalyptic, right? Like, I don't know, whenever you see like dinosaur extinction movies, isn't there always a volcano? And like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.